So, I want to talk to you about Connect Direct, which is a file transfer application. We will have a quick look at this. It's used by people to most by big organizations to transfer files, and some of these files contains really amount of money transfers. If you have questions during the talk, there's asksecopseurope.com where you can leave your questions, and we can get to that later. About me, my name is Hans Freitag. I'm a CEO and owner of a young company which is called Conesphere.com. And I work with Connect Direct for various customers at an administrative level for about 15 years. I desperately trying not to mess these systems up. About Connect Direct, it's a very old program. It's from the mid 80s. As I said before, it's used to transfer files from one computer system to another. One advantage is that it has a host implementation, which was the original cash cow from the original company who developed that tool. Later TCP/IP was added, and Unix and Windows versions were released. I'm mostly in contact with the Unix version of Connect Direct. It's currently owned by IBM. Which bought the previously owning company Sterling Commerce a few years ago. And IBM tells you, Connect Direct provides a security hardened point-to-point file transfer. It lessens the dependency on unreliable file transfer protocol like FTP transfers, and that's a bit suspicious. FTP transfers, we had this in the last decade, it's optimized for it should be optimized for high volume delivery of files within among enterprises. A lot of companies are using this tool to exchange data between different companies, which is very interesting, and there are whole networks of Connect Direct instances around there. So if you have access to Unix, you may have access to an you may get access to an Connect Direct network, and about that security hardened thing, a pro tip is when you have to make a buying decision, buying a tool, you can have a look what documentation is available, and a security hardened product, in my opinion, it definitely needs a security best practice document too. Every application, every modern application has a security best practice document. You see it with Ansible, you see it with Docker, you see it with, you name it. A security best practice document tells you exactly what are the critical points where I have to look when I implement the software. What do I have to look at have a reasonably good security. With that Connect Direct thing, I couldn't find any document telling you this. Let's have a closer look. It's basically an example how things can go wrong. what can go wrong with an application if you don't have a closer look at the security. So a Connect Direct server is called a node. This is a bit of a wording in Connect Direct. You have a primary node, which is the local system. You have a secondary node, which is basically any remote system. And a Connect Direct node can have multiple users, which are usually mapped to system users. And a Connect Direct file transfer is called a job, which is typically submitted on the pnode. However, there is an interesting feature that you can submit a job on an snode. So you can another node is privileged to submit a job remotely. Yeah, before the installation, you find that Connect Direct for Linux is only available in 32-bit version. So best is you have to get a virtual machine which runs a very old, a 32-bit variant of Linux. You might keep that in mind to avoid compatibility issues. And the next thing you might recognize is that the encryption is provided by an option, which is called Secure Plus, and that must be installed separately. So if you install Connect Direct by default, it has no encryption at all, which is a bit of a problem. We have 2018 encryption is around for a very long time, and we should take encryption as default. Installation can be done as user. This is what most companies do. They get an unprivileged user account, and then they start the installation. And at some point, you need to provide an admin privileges because the whole Connect Direct binary is running setuid root, so it can map to different system users. So basically, it's this component is on a Unix system. It is a security critical application that can change the user authority. After the installation, you can look what ports are open. This is also a very interesting look. If you have any new application, just have a look which ports are open on which network interfaces. Most operating systems provide you with a command for that. It's called netstat. It's available in Windows, it's available in Linux, it's available in various other Unix systems. So with netstat, you can have a look through which channels is my application talking. And Connect Direct opens two ports, and it is 130.64, which is the data port, and 130.63, which is a command line interface port. And that command line interface is usually called from the Unix box where the Connect Direct installation is located. The next thing is that the connector, the command line interface port is opened on the public network interface by default. So if you follow the every step in the installation, that port is opened and publicly available. And you can do very interesting things with that command line. You can obviously you can submit a job. It is handled as a background process. A job can transfer files, and a job can run system commands. For example, after a file is transferred, it can touch a flag file. This file is transferred. It can It can read the netmap, alter the netmap. So it can read the configurations. It can alter configuration files. It can do anything what you want. You can transfer a file, run a command to make it executable, executed. No problem at all. You can use ConnectDirect to execute code on remote system. It is a feature, and remote execution, as we all might know, it is always dangerous. So yeah, let's have a look at the node security of that thing. By default, nodes are not authenticated unless encryption is enabled. But actually, there is no check if a node is really the node. If it's unencrypted, if you don't have an encryption available, a node connects to your ConnectDirect, to your local ConnectDirect node. It then tells you who he is, and your ConnectDirect node believes it. And this is actually a bit scary because you can connect from any IP. You can have a system. For example, you can install a system in a DMZ which has external internet access or access to another company, and you think, oh, maybe I start delivering the files via the same ConnectDirect system, but with an unencrypted connection because I'm in the internal trusted network and I can use an unencrypted ConnectDirect transfer to do to upload my files to the DMZ, and then I can run encrypted. So what you can do with that trust level, if you don't check anything, if you don't check the IP address of the remote node, not even that is checked, then the remote node from the outside can pretend he's coming from the inside, and fail. Basically, the command line interface, I think I did something wrong here. It connects via 136.63. This is a typo. But the TCP connection where the command line interface connects to doesn't transport the name of the user who has initiated the connection. But basically, how the software reacts is that it looks up at which user it is running, and if you are able to fake the user where it is running on, for example, you can install a complete operating system in a change root environment and type in any user you want. This is the easiest way. You can also reverse engineer the protocol, but that's not even necessary. So if the ConnectDirect command line interface tells the ConnectDirect server, I'm running with user you name it, then the server believes that. Actually, there is some authentication which is done via a password database, but actually that password isn't changed very frequently by the users. So you can have a guess with the default password, and you can do a scan in the internet, getting some complaints from your provider and finding out which servers are actually running port 130.64 and 130.63 in parallel, and you will find a few with the default password and command line interface available. So one last line of defense is is a sysacl CFG, which prevents the which prevents Connect Direct from mapping to a certain set of users. By default, it is only prevented. The default use setting is that only a user on the P node can be mapped to root. But actually, there are other users, and if you have an admin user who can who can escalate privileges on the system, then you are doomed. Most of Connect Direct application officers are not even aware of this file because it's not readable to normal users for various reasons. So you have to edit this file as root. And as soon as you can execute code on the system, you are doomed. There is another security feature which is called restricted directories. When you configure to which user the Connect Direct system can map to, you can also configure the directories where it can run scripts with a restricted shell, which can have bugs, which can have exploits. All the scripts that you are placing in the restricted shell area, the script itself can be badly designed, and so that they can modify files outside of the restricted shell area. And this is another problem, obviously from the user perspective, because it's not really good tested at all if administrations write scripts. So commands are executed by use of a restricted shell. You can configure upload and download directories. But if we learned anything from the latest NSA breaches, where you can download some backup files from AWS storages, you can figure out that someone will forget to configure these directories properly at some point. Another problem is that many companies do install Connect Direct with the same user that is later used to transfer data, which is a bad idea, because if you do that, you can exchange the binaries. If you do that and then you forget to set one directory, or you forget to enable a node for Secure Plus, You will run into problems, and don't forget there are Connect Direct networks behind those setups. So if you have access to one Connect Direct node, you have you might have enough information to escalate the privileges until you get to the interesting Unix boxes with the interesting data on, and. Another thing is that also the user on which Connect Direct is installed can be guessed very easily. So try CD user, C Direct, Connect Direct. It's a good chance that you get one. So conclusion is from me, Connect Direct isn't security hardened. You can do a secure installation by doing a container for the Connect Direct, put it into the DM set, do another container for the rest of the transfer, which ideally it isn't using Connect Direct at all. There's a lot to mess up with, and lots of very bad defaults, and I haven't seen a single installation done right and done in a safe way. And what me wonders most is that there isn't happening anything yet considering the amounts of data and stuff that is transferred there. So let's go to the questions. Let's see if so if no one has questions, this is already it. Yeah, one?
I have a question. Have you tried notifying IBM about this issue or any other party to have this issue fixed?
Actually, it's not exactly one issue. Yes, I did talk to IBM, but the thing is, you have to rethink the whole development process of that software. At least you can start with building up a security best practices document. We are doing that in my company right now. There are even other IBM applications who have similar problems. In my opinion, the difficult thing is that you have to reinvent the process how IBM makes its software development to actually produce a software that has sane defaults, that is well tested, and that can be shipped at a higher rate, where you can have security fixes faster, and you have to get security in mind there. And it's also not the only application. There are schedulers around who have similar problems. And the whole Unix network has a few flaws. More questions? I can see no one, so thank you very much.